Hallelujah. God is so good. Well, last week, let's pray first. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you, Lord, you've given us the spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of you, that the eyes of our understandings are being enlightened, that we know what is the hope of your calling in our lives and in this church, where the riches of your glory, of your inheritance in us. And Lord, what is the exceeding greatness of your power towards us who believe, according to the working of your mighty power, which you worked in Jesus when you raised him from the dead. We thank you for all your wonderful blessings, Lord. Give you the praise for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Last week I spoke about looking like Jesus. Amen. And that the Bible tells us that we're supposed to look like Jesus. Now, that doesn't mean, ladies, you know, it doesn't mean you're going to have to grow a beard or anything like that. What this is talking about is looking like him in his character, looking like him in his lifestyle, looking like him in his attitudes. And so today we're going to be talking about forgiveness. And Jesus, he taught a lot about forgiveness. We're going to be touching on a lot of different aspects of what, you know, Jesus looks like and what he looked like in the Word of God. And so forgiveness is a critical thing. Jesus got in a lot of trouble with the Pharisees and Sadducees because he was a very forgiving person. And they were very legalistic people. And legalistic people have a problem with forgiveness. Legalistic people are very, you know, judgmental. That they really bring a lot of judgment. And so, you know, Jesus, he's not like that. The Bible says that he's full of grace and truth. Amen? Jesus is full of grace and truth. He's gracious. We as believers, we need to be full of truth, but we also need to be gracious. We need to be full of grace. Being gracious to people. Because people, one thing I know about people is, you know, because I look in the mirror and I see myself, we're imperfect. Amen? Is there anyone here who's reached perfection yet?
No?
I see the halo, you know. It's that's the thing. We all need, I need grace. And so I need to also be able to give grace. And all of you are in the same position. You need to give grace as well because you're in need of grace. So our Heavenly Father, he desires us to look like Jesus. In addition to being our Lord and Savior, Jesus is our godly example in character and lifestyle. So let's look like Jesus the Forgiver. Amen? See, the world must see Jesus in us. If the world is going to see Jesus, it's going to be through his body. It's going to be through each one of us being a part of that body, displaying Jesus, revealing Jesus to the world. The world has dealt with a very judgmental church. The church has been very judgmental in a lot of different ways to the world. But, you know, the Bible says it's the goodness of God that leads to repentance. It's the goodness of God. Jesus, he didn't judge people. He forgave them.
Amen.
He loved them. Amen?
Amen.
See, in Romans 13, verse 14, it says, "But put on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lust." Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. What does that mean? See, we as Christians, we say, "I got Jesus on the inside of me. I've been born again. I'm a new creation. Jesus lives in me." But Jesus doesn't want to just live in us. He wants to live through us. He wants us to display him. He wants to live on the outside of us, not just on the inside of us. We need to display Jesus to the world. That's what's going to attract people to God, is us displaying Jesus to people.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
I remember when Norma and I, you know, when we were married, she sang a song to me. And, you know, it was a few years back. But it was about Jesus in your eyes. I see Jesus in your eyes. And it blessed me. You know? Now, would she sing that today? Maybe sometimes. But there's other times where she'd say, "Oh, Lord, help me. I need more grace." But there are times when she can sing that. You know, "Oh, I see Jesus in his eyes." Amen? But, you know, the world needs to see Jesus in us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
So the Bible says, let's not make any provision for the flesh. Let's not provide for the flesh. You know, when somebody offends us, and what we do, instead of, you know, curse the sin, you know, what we do is we rehearse the sin over and over and over again. We play it back. They did this to me. They said this about me. They offended me. They're you know, and we just replay it over and over again in our mind. And it gets worse every time. You ever notice that? And the offense, the more you meditate on it, the bigger it gets. It just grows. What we're doing is we're giving provision. We're feeding our offense. We're feeding those things that, we're feeding the flesh. The flesh, you know, if the flesh gets slapped, the flesh wants to slap them back, you know. Give me a slap and I'll slap you back. You know, Kellogg's Sugar Snacks, you know, give me a snap. But anyhow, you know, let's not be fit, you know, fueling these things. Let's not be giving provision to our offenses. Amen. Don't provide for the offense over and over again. We need to be gracious. We've got to forgive people.
Yes.
We've got to live a life of being gracious.
Yes. Amen.
And, you know, addicts, that's what they do. They feed their addiction. They keep it alive. If you feed your offense, you will keep it alive, and eventually your offense will eat you up.
Yes.
Yeah.
It'll eat you up. In Titus chapter 2, 11 through 13 says, "For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age." See, if we're not denying the flesh, we're not going to be able to live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age. It says, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. See, our eyes need to be on Jesus. That's what this is saying. This is saying we're looking, we're keeping our eyes on Jesus. And because we're keeping our eyes on Jesus, it's helping us to deny these other things. See, a lot of times we're trying to, you know, we're looking at sin, we're looking at our weaknesses, and then we're wondering why we can't get out of them. God has never told us to look at these things. He told us to look at Jesus. The Bible says in Hebrews 12, 1 and 2, it says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us cast off every sin and every weight that so easily ensnares us, and let us run that race that's set before us." It says, looking unto sin, right? Looking unto weaknesses. Looking unto, no, it says looking unto Jesus, amen, the author and the finisher of our faith, amen. We're not supposed to be focused and be so sin conscious of everything, you know, conscious of, you know, you offended me, or you did this to me, or whatever. We need to look at Jesus. You know, Jesus is our example. Jesus is the picture of perfection for the body of Christ. If we want to act like Jesus, we've got to keep our eyes on Him. Amen?
Amen.
If you look like Jesus, if you look at Jesus, you'll begin to look like Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
If you keep looking at the offense or looking at the sin or looking at the problem, you're going to be stuck there. There's been people who have been stuck in these things all their lives.
Yes.
Or a lot of their lives. And they just can't let go of it. Look at Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Ephesians 4, 21 through 24 says, "If indeed you have heard Him and have been taught by Him, as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning your former conduct, the old man." See, we need to be wearing Jesus on the outside. We've got to put off that old man, "which grows corrupt according to deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of our mind, that you may put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness." If we want to have our... begin to put on that new man, our mind needs to change in these things. We need to begin to see people through Jesus' eyes. We need to begin to see people with Jesus' forgiveness, with the way Jesus dealt with people. Jesus was a forgiver. I mean, when Jesus was on the cross, He said, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. Here, they mocked him. They spit on him. They pulled out his beard. They put a crown of thorns on his head. And Jesus is saying, forgive them, Father. They put nails in him, hung him from a cross. His back was beat raw. I mean, opened up. And Jesus is forgiving him while they're mocking him, while they're spitting on him. Jesus is loving them. Wow. That's our example. Jesus is our example of love. You know, and then we know that the first martyr documented in the Bible, you know, Stephen, what happened with him? He said the same thing. They're stoning him, and he's saying, Father, forgive them. For they don't know what they're doing. Amen?
Yeah.
That's forgiveness. I mean, right in the midst of them doing it, he's still reaching out with love and forgiveness. Wow.
Amen.
You can't do that without God's help. I'm just saying.
That's right.
See, we're supposed to forgive like Jesus. That's how we're supposed to do it. Forgive the way Jesus forgives. Jesus would make the Pharisees so angry because he forgave so freely. The Pharisees would always say, you know, look at them. Look how sinful they are. Look how, you know, rotten they are. You know, who gave Jesus the right to forgive them of their sins? Only God can forgive. Amen? That's the way they saw it. Well, Jesus said that whoever we forgive, their sins will be forgiven. Whoever we retain, they'll be retained. We have the power to forgive. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. And Jesus wants us as his ambassadors to be forgiving people, to be loving people. 1 John 2:6 says, he who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk just as he walked. In other words, look at Jesus, see how he forgave, and you do the same. Do likewise. Amen. Forgive people. I mean, as a pastor, I've had people get so ugly with me, just in my face, ugly kind of thing, and I've had to forgive them. I mean, I can tell you stories, but I'm not going to get into all those. But the point is we need to look like Jesus, even when someone's getting ugly with us. I remember people used to wear those wristbands. Remember those wristbands? What would Jesus do? Amen? And honestly, they were good because they would remind us, okay, how would Jesus handle this situation? I think a lot of times people would forget they were wearing them, though. You know, we almost have to have them tattooed on our forehead, you know, when we look in the mirror. What would Jesus do, you know? And you know, it's just, you know, Christians, we're supposed to be followers of Christ. That's what Christian means. Christian means follower of Christ. Are we following the way he told us to follow him? And I know, it's hard. Forgiveness can be hard. It's because, here's the thing, you can forgive someone and you can still be hurting. Mm-hmm. You know that? If someone breaks your arm, you can forgive them for breaking your arm. But your arm's still going to be aching. Your arm's still going to need to heal up. Amen?
Yeah.
And a lot of times people, they think just because they're hurting that they haven't forgiven. Forgiven me, when you forgive someone, it means you're just not rehearsing it over and over again. You're not holding it against them. But that doesn't mean that, you know, you're not still in the process of getting healed up as well. And so we need to realize that people, they have to trust God. They have to work through their pain. And two of the toughest things to forgive for us, number one, someone who broke our hearts. Someone who we trusted. One of our best friends, a family member, a spouse, one of our children. When they've broken our hearts, they've done something that we never dreamed they would ever do. And it just totally crushed us. That's one of the hardest things to forgive. The people that we love the most, when they hurt us, that's the hardest thing to forgive. But that's the only way to get things healed up. Healing doesn't start until forgiveness comes. Once forgiveness comes, then the healing. See, there's been people who have been injured and broken for 30 years. One moment in time, and they're broken for, and put them out of commission maybe their whole life. But that you have to release that person to God, and then you can receive the healing power of God into your life.
Amen.
Jesus said He came to heal the brokenhearted. Amen?
Amen.
Someone who breaks your heart, that is the hardest thing to forgive. One of them. Or someone who hurts your loved ones. Can I get an amen for that? Someone who hurts your loved ones? Someone who hurt your spouse. Or your children. Or your parents. Someone who came against your parents. That's really a challenge. It's a hard thing to forgive. But Jesus said that we are to forgive. Amen. We are to release people. Release them to God. You know, forgiveness is freedom. When we release people to God, it releases us from the situation. See, Jesus, He freely forgave people who needed it. And, you know, I like in Luke chapter 17, 1 through 5, says, "Then He said to His disciples, 'It is impossible that no offenses should come.'" Offenses are going to come. Jesus promised that offenses were going to come. All of us, at some point in our lives, are going to go through where someone's hurt us. Or we've been offended. He goes on, He says, "But woe to him through whom they do come." Excuse me. "It would be better for him if a millstone was hung around his neck and he were thrown into the sea than that he should offend one of these little ones." I really like what he says in verse 3. He says, "Take heed to yourselves." Okay, yes, offenses are going to come from people, but you need to take heed to yourself. A lot of times we look at the one who did the offending, and we're like, we're taking heed to them. Look at how rotten they are. Look what they said to us. Look what they said about us. You know, they're ruining my reputation. They lied about me. They got me in trouble with the boss. They're out to get me. You know, these things just over and over again. You know, sometimes bosses can be tough. You know, we got to live in forgiveness for our bosses. And they're not always asking for forgiveness either. You know?
No.
We just got to have that gracious heart.
Amen.
Amen?
Yes.
And so He says, "Take heed to yourselves. If your brother sins against you, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you seven times in a day, returns to you, saying, 'I repent,' you shall forgive him." And I love what the disciples say right here in verse 5. They say, "And the apostles said to the Lord, 'Increase our faith.'" Why do they need their faith increased? It takes faith to forgive. Because when you forgive someone, you're trusting the Lord with that person. You're saying, "Lord, I'm putting them in your hands. And Lord, I'm putting my heart in your hands. I'm trusting you that you're going to heal my heart. You're going to heal those things that have been broken." And so, unforgiveness, what you do is you close up your heart. God can't heal your heart when it's all closed up.
Amen.
So when you forgive, you're opening yourself up to the healing power of God. And you're opening yourself up to other people. I mean, I've seen relationships where someone gets hurt by someone that they trust. They've been betrayed by them. And now they won't trust anybody. Everybody's paying for the sins of that one person that offended them.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not fair, but it happens.
Yeah.
And so their heart is closed up. They're not only open to the relationships that they had in the past, but it causes them not to be open to new relationships. Why? Because they might hurt me. I might get hurt by them. So I'm just not open. I'm just all closed up. I've met people like that. You go to reach out to them, and the words that you speak to them just sort of bounce off. Or the gestures of friendship, they just sort of bounce off. They're just closed up to that stuff. We've got to forgive. It takes faith to forgive. And, I mean, Norma and I, we've been through situations. It wasn't our church, but there was a church split years ago. And we were kind of caught in the middle, like a rag doll, you know, pulled between the two. We were the youth ministers at this church. And we loved the pastor, and we loved those who went with him, because he was basically pushed out of the church. And we love all those who were doing the pushing out as well. And so it was really hard. But we had to obey God at the same time. We were hurt, but we stayed in the church that hurt us. And we got healed in the church that hurt us. And why? Because God told us to. And because we did, we didn't take that pain. We didn't take that rejection or that hurt, that disappointment. We didn't take it with us to the next place that God called us to.
Amen.
We didn't carry it around. There's people who are carriers around here. We don't want to be a carrier. Amen?
Amen?
Don't carry your pain. Don't carry your unforgiveness to your next relationship or to your next. You know, people leave a church because they're hurt, and they carry that pain and that to the next church.
Yeah.
You can't. You gotta get healed up. Amen.
Amen. That's right.
Gotta get set free.
Amen.
See, faith in God as our restorer and healer helps us to forgive others. I like this scripture. This scripture has helped me out so much in my life. It's in Luke chapter 6, 27, 28. This Jesus said this. He said, but I say to you who hear. So we also need to be hearers, right? He's saying, I say to you who hear. Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. And pray for those who spitefully use you.
Amen.
When you begin to do this, when you become a doer of this scripture here, it will make you a gracious person. Because you begin to pray for people, and when you're asking God to bless someone who's hurt you, you can't stay angry at them. Something begins to get healed up on your side. You can't curse, you can't bless somebody and curse them at the same time. It just doesn't work. God bless them. I want you to help them. Heal them up so they don't hurt anyone else. Forgive them, Father, because they don't even know what they're doing. And so what happens is you're putting them before God, but then it's changing you at the same time.
Amen.
Your heart becomes more open, like a flower. It just opens up, and you embrace people. And see, I trust people not because I believe that they will never let me down. See, that's where faith comes in. We are open to people, and we forgive people, not because we don't think they're ever going to disappoint us again or let us down. But we're open to them because we know that we have a Lord who can heal us up. We have a Lord who can bind up our wounds. We have a Lord who can bring restoration to our lives.
Amen.
Amen. And so because we have a Lord like that and we put our faith in Him, we can take risks and we can open up to people. Because people are going to do things. People are going to let us down. You know, and we're going to let people down. We need to give grace because we need grace. Amen?
Amen.
When you read the Gospels and you see Jesus, it just reminds me, anyone here ever been to a parade where they throw candy out to all the kids and everything? It just goes on the street and all the kids coming out and gathering up. That's kind of the attitude Jesus had when it came to forgiveness. He just gave forgiveness. You need forgiveness here? Have some. Take some forgiveness. That's just a picture I get of Jesus. He's just extending abundance of grace, full of grace,
Amen.
Abundance of grace to people. You need grace, you're having. Over and over again, even on the cross, He extended grace. Amen?
Amen.
Legalistic hate that. It's the hardest thing, the hardest time for them is to forgive. And God's been dealing with me about this area. There was a minister, I won't give names, but he's a singer. And he fell into sin. And he ended up in divorce. And I was a little critical of that because I really like this singer. And I was, he's remarried. And he's looking to continue on doing what his ministry and stuff. And I just was having trouble with that. But you know, God can forgive. He can forgive divorce.
Yes.
He can forgive murder. He can forgive anything. There is no sin that is too big for Jesus' forgiveness.
Amen.
Amen. And if Jesus can forgive them, then why can't we?
Amen.
Amen. If Jesus can forgive people, we should be forgiving them too. We should be gracious people. Hallelujah. Yeah. So the Lord's worked on me in that area. He used my beloved wife to help me. We had some discussions. She's like, Norma, she's like, boy, you're hard. And I'm like, well, look what he did. And then the Lord got on me and started dealing with me about my attitude. You know, over the past 6 months, the Lord has been really getting me on graciousness. And it just keeps coming up. I think, okay, I got it. And then the Lord shows me something else. And I'm like, oh, you know, Lord, help me. You know, help me to be more gracious to people.
Amen.
Have an attitude of forgiveness before something even happens.
Amen.
You know,
Amen.
See, that's what graciousness is. Graciousness is you already have an open heart that even before someone actually does something against you, you're already ready, set to forgive.
Yes.
That's being a gracious person. That's something that the Lord has been really, really, really working on me. I didn't realize that I struggled in that area, but you know, the Lord made it clear to me one day, probably about 6 months ago, He said to me, He goes, you're not very gracious. And it shocked me at first. And then it really hurt, you know. I was like, oh, man, you know. But, you know, who am I to argue with Jesus? If He tells me I'm not being gracious, then He's right.
Amen.
And I need to change. So this is a process of repenting because I'm still finding areas where I lack graciousness in. And so I'm still... So sometimes repentance can be a process that we're working through. Amen?
Amen.
I know you guys get it the first time. It sometimes it takes me a little while, but God is so patient.
Amen. Amen.
I like in John chapter 8, verse 1 through 11. This is where Jesus, you know, He offered forgiveness to a woman who was caught in the very act of adultery. But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. Now early in the morning, He came again to the temple, and all the people came to Him. And He sat down and taught them. Then the scribes and Pharisees brought to Him a woman caught in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said to Him, Teacher, this woman was caught in adultery in the very act. Now, I thought it took two people to commit adultery. Where was the guy at? This was a definite setup. They already knew where the crime was going to take place. They already knew that it was going to be set up, and they were going to make her the victim of it. You know, Jesus, He's just so smart, you know?
Amen.
So she was caught in the very act. And they said, now Moses, see, they were going by the law. Now Moses commanded us that such should be stoned. But what do you say? Now there's part of that scripture right there. Somehow it didn't get up there. What do you say? This is what the law says. This is what Moses' law says. She should be stoned for this. But what do you say, Jesus? They're speaking to the one who's full of grace and truth.
Amen.
Amen. And this they said, testing Him, that they might have something. Now we're back on what's up there. Something of which to accuse Him. But Jesus stooped down and wrote on the ground with His finger as though He did not hear. Sometimes you just have to act like you don't hear people. Amen? You're praying on the inside. But it just seems like you don't hear on the outside. Amen? You know, be you know, quick to hear, but you need to be slow to speak. Slow to what? Wrath. Amen? So when they continued to ask Him, He raised Himself up and said to them, He who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first. And again He stooped down and wrote on the ground. And those who heard it, being convicted by their conscience, went out one by one, beginning with the oldest, even to the last. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus had raised himself up and saw no one but the woman, he said to her, "Woman, where are those accusers of yours? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No one, Lord." See, the witnesses, they left. They disqualified themselves. They left. So there was no one left to condemn them. "No one, Lord." And Jesus said to her, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." This woman didn't even repent the way we think repenting should be. She knew she was guilty. She knew she needed forgiveness. But Jesus, his heart was so open, he forgave her even before she said she was sorry. He was so gracious. These men, they left. The Pharisees left. Why did they leave? Because they had sin. They weren't perfect, but they also weren't gracious. We need to be gracious because none of us are sinless. None of us have reached perfection. All of us have flaws. There is none of us that have arrived. We're in the process, but we haven't arrived. Amen?
Amen.
We shouldn't be condemning people. We shouldn't be judging people because, honestly, we are in a position where people could do that to us. See, we see things through our little glasses, you know. But people see us other ways. I want people to be gracious with me. Even, you know, I probably have a few flaws. What do you think? No, never mind. Don't ask your wife or your spouse. They know it all. They know the... But,
In detail.
But you know, there's flaws, you know? And we need grace extended to us in our marriages, in our relationships, in our family. We need to give grace to our children.
Amen. Amen.
Because there's going to be times where we're going to need grace from our children.
Amen.
Because we're not perfect parents. We're going to make mistakes along the way. Amen. And we're going to need forgiveness from our kids. So we better learn how to forgive them and teach them forgiveness. Amen? Teach them how to live gracious.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
We need to have some mercy on our loved ones because we want mercy back.
Yes.
In James 2, verse 13, it says, "For judgment is without mercy on the one who has shown no mercy." Mercy triumphs over judgment. This is the word of the Lord. Mercy triumphs over judgment. God prefers mercy over judgment. Amen. Mercy over judgment. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We need to be merciful people. We need to be those who are quick to forgive. Brother Hagin said that the people who receive from the Lord the quickest are the ones who are the quickest to forgive and the quickest to believe. We need to be those kind of people, quick to forgive people and quick to believe God. Now we've all heard of this of the parable of the prodigal son in Luke chapter 15. We're not going to turn there, but we know the story where the youngest son, he wanted to go out and he wanted to live out his life. So he goes to his father and he says, "Father, I want you to give me my inheritance early." So he goes out there and he takes the inheritance and he spends it on wild living, just blowing all the inheritance that his father worked his whole life to achieve. Now, that's a pretty big sin. And so when he did that, famine hit the land and his money ran out. He got desperate. So he ends up, as a Jewish man, he had to go and literally feed the hogs. And hogs are so unclean, they're not allowed to touch them. They're not allowed to even eat them. There's nothing. They need to be separate from them. And here he is. He's feeding the hogs. And not only is he feeding the hogs, he's so hungry, the hog food, the pig pods, look tasty. I don't think so. While he's there pondering about this, desperate, thinking about, "Man, I need to eat something. I'm ready to eat the slop that the pigs are eating." He remembers the goodness of his father. He remembers the way his father treated the servants in his household. He said, "The servants are treated way better than I'm living right now." He said, "You know what? I'm going to go back to my father. And I'm going to repent to Him. I'm going to go back to Him, and I'll just live as a servant under Him, and I'll eat better, I'll dress better, everything will be much better. So he ends up on his way back. He's headed back to his father. And as he's getting there, his father sees him out in the distance. His father was looking for him. Every day, the father would wake up and say, "Where is he at? Where's my son at? I miss my son. I love my son." And he sees his son come. The father doesn't wait for his son to come to him. The father runs to his son and he embraces him. The son is filthy. He smells like a pig. His clothes are a mess. And the father doesn't care. He just embraces him just the way he is.
Amen.
The son says, I've blown everything that you've given me. I made a mess of everything. I don't even deserve to be called your son. Just make me one of your hired servants." And the father just, he ignored that. And he said, "No, you're my son. My son, he was dead, but now he's alive again."
Amen.
And so he went and he put a brand new robe on him, a ring on his finger. He put sandals on his feet. He put a ring, a ring on his finger. He slayed the cat, the fatted cow. And there was a party. And the party was going on. The father was just celebrating, loving his son. His gracious... I mean, this is a picture of Jesus painting of God. This is God. This is what God is like. God's not up there with a whip and a lightning bolt. "Yeah, you messed up again." You know, God is ready to embrace us. And so, you know, the oldest son came. The son who was faithful, the son who always did everything right, the legalistic son, he was angry at the grace that the father extended to his brother. He was like, "I've done this and I've done that. I've always listened to everything you've said. And here you're giving him all the grace. You're giving him all the good stuff." He blew everything. He ruined everything you gave him and that you worked so hard for. And the father's like, "You know what? He's my son." Amen. He encouraged the older son to come in, but he wouldn't even go in to celebrate. And that's the way legalistic people are. When we need grace, and when we've fallen, when we've made mistakes, the legalistic people get angry. They don't want that to happen. They don't want us to receive that grace. But I'm here to tell you today, Jesus is gracious. God is a forgiver, and He wants us to be gracious and be forgivers as well. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Forgiveness has the power to free us from the disappointments and betrayals of the past, so we can remain open to embrace and love people.
Amen.
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 Let's forgive like Jesus. Forgiveness, just remember this, forgiveness is freedom.
Amen.
You're freeing them, and you're freeing yourself.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, I thank you for each person here today. I thank you, Lord, you are an awesome God, full of mercy, full of grace. You're even called the Father of mercies. And so, Lord, I just thank you for helping us to look more like Jesus. Lord, help us and get our minds renewed that we will forgive like Jesus forgives. We will reach out to those who have hurt us, those who have disappointed us, and we will extend grace to them. We will love them. And Lord, we will trust you to heal those areas that have been broken. Our faith is in you, not in them, Lord. We know that we can trust you so we can begin to love people. And so, Lord, we thank you for that. Help us, Lord, to get a revelation of your love and a revelation of your forgiveness. We give you all the praise. We give you all the glory and all the honor for it. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you. We love you. Shake hands. Show yourself to be friendly. Amen. And walk in grace. Walk in forgiveness. Walk in love.
Amen.
Amen.